السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ربنا زدنا علما.
I gave you some homework. And what was that? To find out the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from which ayah?
Ayatul Kursi.
The Ayatul Kursi, what kind of an ayah is it? How did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describe it? As the greatest ayah of the Quran. So why is it the greatest ayah of the Quran? Because it talks about the greatest being. It mentions his names and his attributes. How many names are there at least? 5. And how many attributes at least? 25, 26. Okay. So which ones did you find? Let me ask you. Let's begin from the beginning of the ayah. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah. First of all, we learn about his name. Secondly, from the name Allah, we also learn his attribute, which is Al-Ilah, the God, the one who is worshipped. La ilaha illa hu. From this statement, do we learn a name? No. But do we learn an attribute? Yes. And what is that attribute? The uniqueness of his uluhiyya. Infirad bil uluhiyya, that he is the only one who deserves to be ilah. The only one who deserves to be worshipped. Al-hayy. From this we learn the name Al-hayy. What about any attribute? The attribute of hayat, of life. Al-qayyum. The name of Allah, Al-Qayyum, and also the attribute of Qayyumiyya, which is His self-sufficiency and also His providing and sustaining the entire creation. So how many attributes do we have so far? 4. Okay, 4 attributes we have and 3 names. The first attribute being Al-Ilah, the second being He alone is Ilah, thirdly He has a sifa of Hayat, and fourthly, Qayyumiyya. Then لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. Fifth attribute, which is that he does not sleep or even go near any kind of sleep. Seventh attribute, لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. What does that show? His ownership. Ownership of what? The entire creation. And we learn another attribute from here, the eighth attribute. لَهُ. For him alone, infirad bil mulk, that he alone is the owner. من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه. Another attribute, which is قوة السلطان والكمال, the perfection of his power and majesty and his authority, that no one can even intercede before him without his permission. That just shows how perfect is his power and his might. We learn another attribute from this statement, which is the attribute of indiya, because indahu, near him, which means that some can be near him and others can be far from him. You understand? And remember that indiya, what is it? To be in the presence of someone. All right? To be in the presence of someone. So this shows to us that if someone can be near Allah and another can be far from Allah, that means that Allah is not everywhere. You understand? It shows to us his attribute that he is not everywhere, as many people unfortunately believe that Allah is everywhere. Because if a person holds this belief, then what does it mean? He is everywhere, he's in everything, he's above everything, he's below everything, he's beside everything. And that is something that does not befit him. It does not befit his majesty. Where is he? When he has told us that istawa ala al-arsh, that it means that he's not everywhere. He is on his arsh. From hadith we learn that he descends to the lowest sky. Then what does it mean? He's not always at the lowest sky. You understand? On the day of judgment, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, your Lord will come. So from this attribute, what do we learn? That he is not everywhere. Okay. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. Which attribute do we learn? That his knowledge encompasses everything. Before that, actually, we missed one attribute. Illa bi idnih. Idn. That's the 11th attribute. His idn. That he allows and he also does not allow. He permits and he also does not permit. يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم. This tells us about his attribute of knowledge, comprehensive knowledge that includes everything. And this also tells us another attribute. You see, ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم. What does that refer to? The future and the past, right? What happens to the past? What we know about the past? What happens to us? We forget it. And about the future, what happens? We don't know. We cannot predict. And even if we guess, it's not accurate, right? The reality is always different. So, يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم. This also shows us his attribute that he does not forget. Nor is he unaware. ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء. 14th attribute, which is that لا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء. What is that attribute? Huh? Okay, his مشيئة. Very good. إلا بما شاء. He wills his مشيئة. Another attribute, the 15th attribute, the perfection of his greatness, that of his power, that they cannot encompass him in knowledge. They cannot encompass him in knowledge, and they cannot encompass anything in knowledge unless Allah allows. Okay. Another attribute, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. We learn about his kursi. Okay, he has a kursi. Then we also learn about his عظمة, his قوة, his قدرة, because وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. It encompasses the skies and the earth. It includes the skies and the earth. How vast is his kingdom? Just imagine. How vast is his creation? If the creation is so big and so vast, then how great and amazing is the Creator? How powerful he is. So this section alone, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, this alone tells us about so many of his attributes. His knowledge, his power, his uniqueness, his greatness. وَلَا يَؤُدُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. وَلَا يَؤُدُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. Which attribute do we learn? Okay, that he does not get tired. What else? That he is the protector. Good. What else? He's a sustainer. He's the guardian. He's the one who knows. He's the provider. Because you see, preserving something requires a lot of other skills, right? It means that he must necessarily possess other attributes. Because if he is preserving, he is looking after, he is maintaining the entire creation, then it means he is the most knowledgeable. He's the most aware. That means he is also the most merciful. That means he is the most wealthy. So his resources never end. وَلَا يَؤُدُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. الْعَلِي, الْعَظِيمُ, more names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Ayatul Kursi, in which Allah's names, his attributes are mentioned. And in particular, we learn about many names which are affirmed, many attributes which are affirmed, and also some attributes which are negated from him. We learn about Nafi as well as Isbat. All right. وَلِهَذَا كَانَ مَنْ قَرَأْ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ. This is the reason why whoever recites this ayah. What does it mean by this? This is the reason why. Meaning this is how powerful this ayah is. Because it mentions the names and attributes of Allah. This is the reason why this ayah is the greatest. And this is the reason why it is the most powerful. That when a person recites it in the night, then throughout the night he is protected. Shaitan cannot come near him. And that person is safe and protected from any possible harm. وَقَوْلِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ. And his statement, glory be to him, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. And rely, trust upon the ever-living, the one who does not die. Again, over here in this ayah, there is nafi as well as isbat. There is affirmation and negation. Affirmation of what? الحيات, الحي. And negation of maut. La yamut, he does not die. So remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses both kinds of attributes. Meaning some attributes are affirmed for him and other attributes are negated from him. Why? Because they do not befit him. So over here, what is being said? Rely upon the ever living, the one who does not die. Meaning, don't rely on those who live and die. Those who are not eternal. And who are they? The creation. Right? Whether it is a person, or a machine or a house or a car, anything. They're not worthy of being relied upon. Why? Because they will die. And someone who will die, someone who cannot protect himself from finishing, from ending, then how can he protect you? And how can he help you? If they will die, that means there will be a time when they will not listen to you, when they will not understand you, when they cannot help you because they cannot help themselves. So are they worthy of being relied upon? No. So therefore, don't rely on the creation, don't rely on people, don't depend on them if you want to be happy, if you want relief, if you want comfort. Why? Because people, they will die. They leave, they go away, they move away, they become distant. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is above this. What is tawakkul? Trust and reliance. What does it mean? Tawakkul basically means it's from wakala. And wakala is to entrust something to another. That you have an issue, you have something to do, you have a problem to deal with. So you entrust it to someone else. That please do this for me, you solve this issue for me, or you help me solve this. For example, you have to calculate your taxes. You know you cannot do it yourself. So what do? You take all of your receipts and all of your, you know, every detail of your finance. You take it to who? Someone who can help you figure it out. Why? Because you cannot do it yourself. So you entrust something to another. It doesn't mean that you leave the entire matter to them. No, you have to be part of the equation, right? You have to be part of solving the problem. Because otherwise they will see a purchase and they don't know what it is. Is this a business expense? Is it a personal expense? You understand? So they need you to be part of it. Now, tawakkul is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means, first of all, sidqul i'timad ala Allah, sincere reliance upon Allah. Meaning that you do not ask except Him. You do not seek help except from Him. You do not have hope except in Him. In Him alone. Sidqul i'timad ala Allah. And it is for what purpose? For the purpose of seeking some benefit or in order to be protected from some harm. You want something or you want to be saved from some harm. And this is the reason why you rely upon Him. But how do you rely upon Him? مَعَ الثِّقَةِ بِهِ. While having trust in Him, while holding on to Him. Because sometimes what happens is that we have an issue. Okay, we have some big problem in our life. We want to be safe from some danger, from some harm. We say, yeah, Allah will take care of it. I have faith in Allah. I have trust in Allah. But are we making any dua for it? Are we doing any istighfar? Are we holding on to Him, reaching out to Him? Tawakkul includes that. You know, like when you ask someone to do something for you and you trust that they will do it, you just tell them once. What do? You request them again and again, remind them, and show your weakness before them, your dependence on them, the fact that you need their help desperately. So tawakkul is not just, yes, Allah will take care of me. Tawakkul is also that you reach out to Him. You beg Him. You get up in the middle of the night. You ask Him in the morning. You ask Him in the evening. You remember Him through the day. You cry before Him. You express your needs, your feelings, verbally or in your heart. However, وَفِعْلِ الْأَسْبَابِ الصَّحِيحَ. And at the same time, using the correct means. Using the correct means also. Meaning, don't just leave the matter to Him, but اِعْقَلْ وَتَوَكَّلْ. Tie the camel and then rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So do what is within your capacity also. Now, sometimes we rely on people. We depend on them. We attach ourselves to people. What happens? We become miserable. We become unhappy because people disappoint us. Okay. Another is that a person relies upon himself. He says, I don't need anybody. I'm just going to take care of this myself. I'm capable. I'm strong. I can do this. He relies upon himself. What happens to such a person? He is disgraced. Because he realizes that he is incomplete. He cannot look after himself all by himself. He is disgraced. How? There are many examples of this, that when a person relies upon his strength, his numbers, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes him taste what? Some level of defeat or failure, some level, whether a lot or a little. Remember what happened to the Muslims at Hunayn? What happened? They were so amazed by their own numbers and their strength, they thought they could do it. They thought they could do it. So what happened? They lost initially. They lost initially. Now, and there is another way that sometimes people rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they don't use any means without putting in any effort themselves. This is not sincere tawakkul. This, in fact, is a form of foolishness and deficiency in religion, because it's an obvious criticism of Allah's wisdom. Obviously, if Allah is going to help you, it's going to be through some means, right? Allah has given you the intellect, He's given you the means. Now, it's your job. You rely on Him, you reach out to Him, you pray to Him, and at the same time, you do what is within your capacity. But if you expect for miracles, you begin expecting miracles, and you say, oh, it doesn't happen, then what is this? This is almost mocking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is also incorrect. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ. Rely upon who? The ever-living. And this tawakkul is so important because it is half of religion. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. One half is ibadah. And the other half is إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We seek your help. And seeking Allah's help means what? Relying upon Him. So this tawakkul needs to be correct. Then the second title, الجمع بين علوه وقربه وأزليته وأبديته. الجمع meaning combination. Combination of what? His attributes. Which attributes? بين between علوه, his علو. What is علو? Exaltedness. وقربه and his قرب. What is قرب? Closeness, nearness. وأزليته and his أزلية. أزلية is eternity. It's basically when something is without any beginning. So, azaliyatihi, the fact that he was always there, he is eternal, was always there without any beginning. Wa abadiyatihi. Abadiyatihi, his abadiyya. What does that mean? When something is everlasting, it's endless, it will remain forever. So, at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses all of these attributes. Which attributes? The fact that He is exalted, the fact that He is near, the fact that He always was, and He will always remain. And this is amazing. Who else can be like this? Just think, He has ulu, He is high, in fact He is the highest, so no one is with Him or above Him. And yet He is near. Yet at the same time He is near. He was always there and He will always remain. So He is without any beginning or any end. So what does it mean then? That He has encompassed everything from beginning to end. He has ihata kul. Right? Because He is the highest and at the same time He is the most intimate, the closest one. That means that everything in between, He has full control over it. If He always was and always will be, then what does it mean? Everything in between? He has full control over it. وَقَوْلِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ. And His statement, glory be to Him. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. He is the first and the last and the ascendant and the intimate, and He is of all things knowing. Four names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned over here. And these names, they show us His ulu, His qurb, His azaliyah, His abadiyah. First name is Al-Awwal. And what does Awwal mean? The first. So first means there was none before Him. Which means that He always was. He always existed. The second name is Al-Akhir. What does Akhir mean? Last. And this means that there will be none after Him. Which means that He will always be, He will always remain. The passage of time makes no difference to Him. No difference. The third name in this ayah is Al-Zahir. And Al-Zahir, we think that Zahir is one who is apparent. But that's not the meaning. Zahir over here gives the meaning of highest. The name of Allah, Al-Zahir, means the one who is highest. Meaning none is above Him. Because zuhur, it means ulub. Zuhur means to be high. You see, we learned at the beginning of this book, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. What does it mean by ظُهُور over there? That he makes the religion dominant, overcome. Okay, and what is dominant, what overcomes the other, is where? Above, higher. Okay, from this is also ظَهْر. ظَهْر is the back of an animal. And that is also the topmost part. Okay, so also we learn about the يَأْجُوجْ مَأْجُوجْ فَمَا اسْتَطَاعُوا أَيْ يَظْهَرُوهُ. They're not capable to climb over, go over the wall. Okay, so going over requires going high. Okay, so الظَاهِر means he is the highest. So none is above him. He is the highest. The fourth name that is mentioned here is Al-Batin. And Batin, again, sometimes we understand that this is hidden. But Batin over here means closest. Because what is hidden is the closest to something. Closest to that object. Okay? But with respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Batin means the closest. So none is closer than him. It gives the meaning of qurb. He's the most intimate meaning. So all of these names, awwal, akhir, zahir, batin, what do they tell us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That he has encompassed everything. And wahuwa bi kulli shay'in alim. He is knowing of everything. Meaning while possessing these perfect attributes, he is also knowing of everything. So now, learning these ayat, does that give us a better understanding of who our Lord is? Because through these verses we come to know of His attributes, of His names, of His characteristics. And this is the reason behind why we're studying Aqeedah. To build our Iman. To strengthen our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third, إِحَاطَةُ عِلْمِهِ بِجَمِيعِ مَخْلُوقَاتِهِ. إِحَاطَة means to encompass. إِحَاطَةُ عِلْمِهِ. His ilm has encompassed. It has included. What does it encompass? بِجَمِيعِ مَخْلُوقَاتِهِ. His entire creation. The entire creation is encompassed by his knowledge. Meaning he knows about everything and everyone. Nothing is outside of his knowledge. You understand? Meaning, if there is anything, he knows about it. If there is anything, he knows about it. And if he doesn't know about it, then what does it mean? It's not there. You understand? This is why in the Quran we learn, قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ. Are you telling Allah? Are you informing Allah? Meaning, if you're trying to tell him about something, presuming that he doesn't know, it means that he doesn't exist. That it doesn't exist. Because if it existed, he would already know about it. Because إِحَاطَةُ عِلْمِهِ بِجَمِيعِ مَخْلُوقَاتِهِ. He has encompassed everything in his knowledge of his creation. What's the evidence of this? وَقَوْلِهِ, and his statement, وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ, and he is the knowing and the wise. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Okay. There is a small error over here. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ is the ayah from Surah Al-Tahrim. Okay, ayah number 2. And what is mentioned over here, there's actually an ayah missing in this text. Okay, which is why when you look at other texts of Aqeedah Wasatiyah, you will find this ayah. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. And that is Surah Al-Tahrim, ayah number 2. And then, وَقَوْلُهُ, and his statement, الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. Okay, but there's no وَهُوَ before that. العليم الخبير, and that is Surah Al-Tahrim, ayah number 3. العليم الخبير, that is mentioned here, وهو, that's not part of the ayah. Because the ayah ends with قال نبأني العليم, عليم الخبير. Okay? And before العليم الخبير is وهو العليم الحكيم. Surah Al-Tahrim, ayah number 2. So, the names of Allah, العليم الحكيم, what do they tell us? First of all, about His ilm. And we have learned about the attribute of knowledge before also in Ayatul Kursi, that Al-Alim, he knows, he has knowledge of what? Everything and everyone. He encompasses everything in knowledge. And Al-Hakim. Al-Hakim is who? The most wise. Remember that Al-Hakim is from Hikmah, and it's also from Hukm. Hukm means to give a command, to make a judgment. So Allah, He is Al-Hakim, meaning all Hukm is for Him. He decides. He judges. Okay? He decides. He judges. Ihkam is itqan, to make something firm. Okay? To make something properly, firmly. And that cannot be except without wisdom, hikmah. So any judgment that Allah makes, it is firm. And it's based upon His wisdom. Any judgment, any command, any ruling, whether it is kawni or shar'i, whether it has to do with the matters of the universe, okay, or it is to do with the matters of the deen. And remember that He is Al-Hakim, meaning He's the most wise, so there is wisdom in how something is and also in its consequence. Okay, so for example, water, if it is of a particular nature, consistency, there is wisdom behind that. Because imagine if water was thick. Just imagine, if it was thick, like thick in its consistency, would it be usable? Have you ever tried applying honey on your hands or on a burn or a wound? What happens? It's sticky. Or you have to rub in order to wash it off. Imagine if water was like that. Life would be so difficult. So there is hikmah in behind how something is. Its color, its shape, its size, its nature, its consistency. And also in its objective or in its consequence, meaning the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it, why He has legislated it. He is Al-Hakim. And tell me something, making this kind of judgment, ruling, okay, hikmah, what does that require? Ilm? Knowledge? So again, this emphasizes His ilm. وَقَوْلِهِ and His statement, الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. He is Al-Alim and He is also Al-Khabir. Al-Alim means the one who knows. Khabir is who? The one who is aware. What's the difference between knowledge and awareness? Basically the same thing. Right? But why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us that He has ilm and He also has khabr? Because apparently it seems like it's the same thing, but it's not the same. There is a difference between ilm and khabr. Ilm is to know the surface of something. The zahir of something. And khabr is to know the batin, what is inside. So for example, knowledge is to know, okay, this is an apple. Ilm, you know that this is an apple, it's not an orange. But khabr is what? That when you taste it, you know that it is sweet. Okay? Now, to have khabr of something, do you need more, as a human being, do you need more knowledge? Or do you need more experience? Yes. Okay? If someone has not tasted an apple, what do they know? They don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Alim and Khabir. He knows the apparent and He also knows what is inside, what is hidden. We are weak and we need to experience in order to know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above that. He knows. Al-Alim, Al-Khabir. Now if you think about it, ilm in the general sense, does it not include every detail? Knowledge in the general sense includes every detail. Right? So for example, apple. I mean, if you know that it's an apple, you should know that apples are generally sweet. Right? It's part of general knowledge. But when al-alim and after that al-khabir is mentioned, then what is being emphasized? That He knows that which is hidden. Because it's being mentioned in two ways, in the general sense and also in a specific sense. So it shows how this is being emphasized, that He knows the hidden, the most secret matters also. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا وَمَا يَنْزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا يَعْلَمُ He knows مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ, that which goes into the earth. What goes in the earth? The dead, they are buried in the earth. What else goes into the earth? Seeds. What else? Water that's absorbed by the earth. What else? So many different creatures. The other day I got this plant to keep indoors. And I moved it. I had watered it, so I moved it from its place. And Under it, I found something moving. I'm like, what is this? It looked like a snail, but it wasn't actually a snail. It was basically a grub. And I was amazed at how this thing was living inside this pot. And I had no idea. Because if I knew that this creature was inside this pot, I would have never put it inside my kitchen. Right? He knows what goes in the earth, what is hidden in the depth of the earth. He knows about it. We just look at the surface, right? But he knows what is inside. We don't even know what all is buried within the earth. What's entering the earth? Which snake is going in from where? And which water is being absorbed where? Which roots are taking in the water? Where it's going? Which dead is being buried right now where? Allahu a'lam. He knows all of this. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ. He knows what enters into the earth and what goes into the earth and what it will turn into. What it will become. What is turning into oil and what is turning into coal and what is turning into other minerals. He knows. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا. And whatever comes out of it. What comes out of the earth? Okay, plants, they grow out. What else comes out of the earth? Okay, so many minerals, they're extracted. What else? Even water comes out of the earth, right? And so many creatures, they are born inside the earth and they make their way out of the sand. They make their way out of the earth as if dead are being resurrected. You know, for example, turtles, they lay their eggs deep inside the sand. And when those eggs hatch and the babies, they come out, they make their way out of the sand. So you literally see a head poking out and then arms and then the entire creature comes out. So he knows what is coming out from where. He knows ما يخرج منها. Gold is extracted, minerals are extracted. He knows which seed will open up and which will not. وما ينزل من السماء. And whatever comes down from the sky. What comes down from the sky? Rain, hail, snow, what else? Angels. Revelation was sent. Allah's commands. Right? They are brought down. So, مَا يَنْزِلُ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ. And whatever that goes up, meaning whatever ascends into the sky, whatever goes up through the sky. And what is that? Deeds. What else? The souls of people. Right? When they're taken, angels go up, du'as go up. And when a person praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those words of tasbih also, they rise up. And you know how far they go? When a person glorifies Allah, when a person remembers Allah, these words, they rise up. You know how far they go? To the arsh. In a hadith we learn, and this hadith is in Sunan Ibn Majah, the Prophet ﷺ said that what you mention of tasbih and tahleel and tahmeed, meaning whatever words of dhikr you say, saying subhanallah, la ilaha illallah, alhamdulillah, these words, they revolve around the arsh. They revolve around the arsh, buzzing like bees. The sound, you know, you say it here. You say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah. But what happens, these words, they rise up to the arsh, and around the arsh they revolve, and the sound, you know, you're making the sound here, but that sound is buzzing like bees over there. And they remind of the one who said it. Meaning they mention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the person who said those words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wouldn't any of you like to have or continue to have something that reminds of him? Meaning that mentions him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wouldn't any one of you like that someone is mentioning you to your Lord? Wouldn't you like that? So this is basically an encouragement. Tasbih, tahleel, and tahmeed. And these days, what should be done? What did the Prophet ﷺ say? These are the best days and فَأَكْثِرُوا فِيهِنَّ. Do a lot of tasbih, tahmeed, tahleel. Now the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. What comes down, what goes up, what goes in, what comes out. Everything. What does that tell us? He includes everything in knowledge. So, when he knows everything, is his word reliable? Yeah? Does it need to be proven by some scientific research? No. So anything that we find in the Quran, what should be our attitude towards it? Accept it without any doubt, without any hesitation, because it is the most truthful, the most accurate statement.
وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّاهُ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ.
Again, in this ayah, what do we learn? About Allah's knowledge, His complete knowledge. وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ. And with Him are the keys of the unseen. لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّهُ. None knows them except Him. Only He knows about those مَفَاتِح. مَفَاتِح, keys. What is a key? If you have the key to something, what does it mean? You have some treasure. Okay? Because only a treasure needs to be locked and secured. You understand? So, مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ, one meaning is treasures of the unseen. Meaning all those treasures that are out there, valuables, resources, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns. They're hidden, meaning people don't know about them. People get worried that we're going to run out of this and run out of this. But Allah has the treasures. He has them. And when you own the treasure of something, then what does it mean? You take it out according to your own decision. Right? So Allah has the treasures, the storehouses, and He gives from His rizq whenever He wants, how much ever He wants. Because the control is with Him. You understand? Another meaning of mafatih is key. What does the key mean? The opening of something. When you have the key, and when you unlock, then what does it mean? You are opening, you are beginning, you know, your access to the other side. Okay, so mafatih has also been understood as the beginning. The beginning of what? That matter which is of the unseen, and only Allah knows about it. And remember that these are five. These are five matters, which are known only to Allah, okay, and they are part of the unseen. And which ones are they? That we learn from the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. First of all, knowledge of the hour, meaning when it will happen. Because the hour is the key to afterlife. It's the beginning. Once that will be unlocked, then what will happen? The afterlife will begin. So you understand how it is the beginning? Okay. وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ. He sends down the rain. Now the rain is also the key. Key to what? Life of the earth. It's the beginning of the life of the earth. If there's no rain coming down from the sky, then what will happen? Plants will die, creatures will die. But when rain will come, then what will begin? Life will begin. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. He knows what is in the womb. What is in the womb, this is the beginning of a new life. Right? Because when that will come out, when that will be born, then a new life will begin. New creature will live. Fourth, وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. No soul knows what it will earn tomorrow. What will happen tomorrow is key to future earnings. Right? It's the beginning of what of your future, meaning what you will acquire in the future. So he knows about that. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٌ. The fifth, the place of death. No soul knows in which land it will die. And death is the key to the afterlife of an individual. It's the beginning of his new life. Life in barzakh. So, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ. These five matters, who knows them? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There, it is His decision when He will unlock, when He will begin. You see? The hour, who can begin it? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rain, who can send it? Only Allah. Birth, when can it take place? Only when Allah wills. Right? Likewise, what will happen tomorrow? When can you get that? Only if Allah allows. Which place you will die at? Only Allah knows about that. And only when a person will reach a particular place, then he will die. And remember the story of that prophet who was meant to die up in the skies? Right? And Prophet Idris, I believe. And then what happened? When the angel of death came to take his soul, because every prophet is given a choice, that either you die now or you get some more time. Right? So he was basically going up to see if he could get an extension in that particular sky. The Malakul Maut, he found him and he said, I was wondering how I was meant to take your soul over here. So a person will only die where he is destined to. Right? And that knowledge is only with who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, it's amazing. Not right, not left. You know, sometimes death takes place at such a specific, you know, as a result of such a specific incident. A person was driving on a particular road. He made that wrong decision. Okay? Turned left or, you know, swerved to the left. And at that same second, you know, a car was coming from the opposite side and the crash happened. So many things happen at once so that the person could die at that place. So, لا يعلمها إلا هو. Only he knows about these matters. No one knows them but him. No angel, no prophet, even the angel of death. Like in the case of Prophet Idris, like he didn't have any clue as to how it was going to happen. Only Allah knows. Jibreel came and asked the Prophet ﷺ, مَتَ السَّاعَةَ? And what was the answer? The one who is being asked does not know any better than the one who is asking. Jibreel does not know, the Prophet ﷺ does not know. وَيَعْلَمُ And he knows, meaning he has more knowledge. Besides this also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows more. And what is that? مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ Whatever that is in the land and in the sea. Only known to him. Do we even know what all is there on the surface of the earth? We probably don't know what all is there on the surface of our house or the floor of our house. We don't know. We cannot count. And the mountains also, which are on the earth, okay, what's inside them, what is on them, only Allah knows. And He knows what should be where, okay, because He knows what is on the land. So He knows that this person should be in this country and that person should be in that country and this person should be in this city and that person should be in that city. Because sometimes we cannot understand. Why? Why is it that this earth has to be so big so me and my friends or me and my family have to be so many miles apart? يَعْلَمُ He knows. مَا فِي الْبَرِّ Whatever is on the earth. And there is a reason behind that. There is hikmah behind that. Think about it. How Musa alayhi salam was taken away from Egypt, in Madian, and then from Madian, sent back to Egypt. He knows what is on land, what is going from one place to the other. He allows it, or he doesn't allow it. He trains, he teaches through different ways. So it is his decision to place whatever, wherever. And whatever that is in the bahr, in the sea. What is in the sea? More than we can even imagine. More than we can even count. Fish that are blind and fish that can see, fish that are clear and fish that are colorful, big and small. وَمَا تَسْقُطُ And it does not fall. مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ Any leaf, إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا Except that he knows it. If he knows the falling leaf, then it means he knew the leaf even before the leaf fell. He knows the growing leaf, the leaf when it was growing, and then what sat on it. And how long it stayed, and the colors that it changed, and then eventually when it fell, and what caused it to fall. And the falling leaf, what does it signify? A changing season, right? So he knows about all those details also. وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ And there is no habba, no seed, in the darkness of the soil. Because where are seeds? Inside the soil, right? And what is inside the soil? Darkness. So even if something is hidden in the darkness of something, buried within something, he knows about it. وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ And there is nothing fresh or dry. Fresh, رَطْب is basically wet, so fresh, alive, colorful, growing, and yabis, dry, colorless, or brown, or dead, not moist at all. إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ Except that all of this is in a clear record. So what does it mean? That all of this is known to him, and at the same time, it's also recorded. You know how difficult data entry is? Think about it, how difficult it is to enter data accurately, to write something, to record it. So many mistakes and errors, which is why it's proofread once and twice and more times, and still in the final print, what do you see? Errors and mistakes. And then sometimes what happens is that you write something out first. You make a plan. And in order to make a plan, there's so many things, so much effort that's gone into, so much brainstorming. And then once that plan is written, is it executed the same way? Is it? It's never executed the same way. You go to an event, you're given a timetable, a schedule. You're told, at this time, this will happen. And as soon as you get there, you're told, we're running half an hour late. Just imagine, all of this is in Allah's knowledge, and everything is written, which means that it is finalized, decided from before, and finalizing information is very difficult. Then processing all of that, executing all of that, is even far more challenging for us. So what does this ayah show? That everything that is happening, even the falling of a leaf, is happening according to a plan. His knowledge, meaning his plan. وَكُلُّ صَغِيرٍ وَكَبِيرٍ مُسْتَطَرٍ. Every small and big thing is written. It's recorded, meaning it's finalized. And it will be executed in that way. The next ayah, وَمَا تَحْمِلُ مِنْ أُنْسَى وَلَا تَضَعُ إِلَّا بِعِلْمِهِ. مَا تَحْمِلُ, it does not carry, مِنْ أُنْسَى, any female, وَلَا تَضَعُ, nor does it deliver, إِلَّا بِعِلْمِهِ, except with his knowledge. أُنْسَى over here refers to every female, whether human or animal. So whatever it bears, meaning whatever it conceives, whatever goes in, where it rests, how it grows, how much it grows, how much it develops is known only to him. And لَا تَضَعُ, every child that is born, every child, human or animal, every birth that takes place is known to him. Imagine every hatching of an egg. Just imagine, whether it is a bird or a fish, any egg that opens and from it, a creature comes out, a baby comes out. It happened with his knowledge. Any woman that gives birth. So many births are taking place, right? All over the world. Who knows? We cannot even keep track. So many births, they're not even registered. Isn't it? I was watching this documentary recently. It's a girl. But how these words are the most dangerous words that could be said in India. How many female children, okay, their births are not even recorded. They're not even registered. Why? Because the girl is born and killed. Born and killed. Born and killed. There are about 2 million girls. 2 million girls that have been lost like this, if not more. This is just an estimate. Just imagine. But people may not know, he knows, that that child was born and it was killed. So he will hold accountable. Next ayah, لِتَعْلَمُوا, so that you know, أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ, that indeed Allah is capable, he has قُدْرَة, he has the ability over what? كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, everything. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا, and that indeed Allah, he has encompassed everything in his knowledge. Notice the first word, لِتَعْلَمُوا, you should know, meaning this should be known to who? Everyone, all of us. This should be known to all of us. What? That Allah is able to do anything. Why? Because he knows everything. And everything is in his control. Nothing can escape him. What happens to people? What happens to us? Just because we know something doesn't mean we can do it. And doesn't mean that we have power over it. Like, for example, a disease is diagnosed. The entire detail is there. This is the problem with the blood. This is happening or this is not happening. The entire report is there. All the numbers are there. But can we do anything to fix it? So many times we know, but we are sitting helplessly. You know, we cannot do anything at all. But he is ala kulli shay'in qadir. And at the same time, he possesses knowledge. So he knows and he can also do whatever he wants. Sulaiman alayhi salam, how much knowledge did he have? A lot. Even he knew the language of the birds. So much so that when one bird was missing, Hudhud, he knew. But what happens with us? So many are missing and we don't know. So many things go missing and we have no clue. We don't have any idea. After so long, we realize, oh, where did that thing go? I haven't seen it in so long. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows even more than Sulaiman alayhi salam. Sulaiman alayhi salam understood the communication of the ants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how the fish communicate and why they communicate and what they communicate, and the ants also, and so many other creatures also that we don't know about, we don't even understand. You know, it's amazing how people will spend their entire lives living amongst animals just so that they can better know them and understand them. They can better understand why they behave in a particular way, or why they eat something, or why they go somewhere. And it's amazing how so many researchers have literally dedicated their lives. But still, despite all that experience, do they have complete knowledge? No. It's just scratching the surface. But Allah, لِتَعْلَمُوا, you should know that أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا وَقَوْلِهِ, and his statement, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينُ, indeed, it is Allah who is الرزاق, he is ذُو الْقُوَّةِ and he is الْمَتِينُ. Two names and three attributes. الرزاق, who is الرزاق? The provider, the one who gives rizq. Raziq also gives rizq. رزاق, what does that show? One who gives a lot of rizq and one who gives rizq to all. Just imagine the numerous creatures that are there. How much they eat, how much they consume, and who's providing them continuously, day in and day out? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What happens to us when we have to feed two people, or just ourselves even? Even that becomes such a chore. Because first of all, getting the money, and then getting the food, and then preparing the food, and then sitting and eating, and then feeding others, that takes so much time. So much so that if one person is dedicated to just, you know, taking care of the food of people, he cannot do other things. So much time goes into this. So much energy goes into this. If you cook one day, you can't clean. If you cook one day, you can't wake up early enough. It happens with many people. It exhausts us. Feeding just one family exhausts us. Allah is ar-razzaq. And we are stingy also, aren't we? We will give rizq. You know, for example, a little bit of food to one person one day, and then the next day we won't. Why? Because they hurt us, or they didn't turn back and say thank you. Right? We will give one cookie, but not another cookie after that. Allah is al-Razzaq. You know, an adult blue whale, it can eat up to 40 million krill in one day. What is krill? Shrimp-like creature. 40 million. Now, what does that mean? Go a little deep. 40 million krill, if they're being eaten every day by a whale, that means 40 million krill are being created also. And they're eating something also. Because it's a food chain, right? One thing becomes a food of the other. Now imagine 40 million krill are just consumed by a whale in one day. How many krill in 1 week? Think about it. If a family grows one more child, then all of a sudden, people start looking at numbers and figures. But this means this much money will be needed for their education and for their diapers and their food, right? And for travel, then one extra ticket. Okay? So we start worrying because we are limited. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is al-Razzaq. Have you ever looked into how much it costs into having a particular pet? Huh? So for example, a cat can cost up to almost $1,000 a year. It can. All the vet visits and the vaccinations and one thing after the other and the food. It's costly. And there's so many cats living out in the wild. Who's providing them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who's protecting them against disease? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allaha huwa al-Razzaq. So, why is this ayah mentioned? Because rizq cannot be given except with ilm, knowledge. Because obviously, when someone is hungry and they tell us, I am hungry, I need this, and you get to know about their hunger, then you give them. Or you know that this food they need. This is when you give them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to everybody, even before people ask. Even before the creation asks Him. He is Ar-Razzaq. Now remember that rizq is of two kinds. It is of two kinds. One is aam and the other is khas. Aam, general rizq, general provision that fulfills physical needs that the body benefits from. Clothes, food, sunlight, air, water. This is benefiting the body. Physical needs are being fulfilled through this rizq. The second type of rizq is khas, specific, that which sustains, you can say, the deen of a person. What the religion is established with. Because spirituality, that is also a part of us. And that also needs food. That also needs sustenance. And what is the sustenance for spirituality? Two things, mainly. Ilm and motivation to do amal. So Allah is Ar-Razzaq, meaning He gives ilm al-nafir also. And He gives the motivation to people also so that they will worship Him. Right? So for example, He gives tawfiq, He gives mahabba, He gives khashya, He gives hope. And because of these factors, a person is motivated to worship Allah more and more. So He is Ar-Razzaq. And He is Dhul Quwwatil Mateen. Dhul Quwwah. What does that mean? Possessor of strength. Possessor of Quwwah. Before that, He is Ar-Razzaq. So what does it mean? Should we seek rizq from Him? If we need rizq, whether it is knowledge or food or money or any kind of vitamin that is deficient in our body, anything, who do we ask? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Should we ask Him because He's Razzaq anyway? He's going to give it anyway. Should we still ask Him? Yes. Because asking is a means of acquiring. How should we ask? How? Okay, make dua. When? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when would he make dua for rizq? Fajr. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an wa 'amalan mutaqabbalan wa rizqan tayyiba. Fajr. And remember that dua, when it's made at the end of salah, then what does it mean? Before the taslim. So before the taslim, he would make this dua. Many times we are worried about rizq, about food, about money, about bills. And we express our concerns before people, but we don't express our concern before Allah, who can provide, who is the only one who can provide. Because if someone is going to give us, they can only give us if Allah puts it in their heart. So that they understand your need and they have mercy for you, or they have some affection for you, and then they help you and then they give you. So the giver is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a hadith we learn, this is a hadith in a silsilatu sahiha, that a Bedouin man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, allimni khayran, please teach me something good. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam held his hand and he said to him, Qul subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Say these words. So the Bedouin man, he counted these four adhkar on his fingers. And he went away. But then as he was walking away, he stopped. The Prophet ﷺ smiled. He said, he's thinking. And then the Bedouin man, he came back to the Prophet ﷺ. He came back and he said, Ya Rasulullah, these words, هذا لله. This is all for Allah. Yani, subhanallah, I'm glorifying Allah, alhamdulillah, I'm thanking Him, la ilaha illallah, I'm mentioning His oneness, Allahu Akbar, I'm mentioning His greatness, this is all for Allah. Fama li, what is for me? I want something for myself. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, Ya A'rabi, when you say subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, sadaqta, you have spoken the truth. When you say alhamdulillah, Allah says, صَدَقْتَ, you have spoken the truth. When you say, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, Allah says, صَدَقْتَ, you have spoken the truth. And when you say, Allahu Akbar, Allah says, صَدَقْتَ, meaning you have spoken the truth. And when you say after that, اللهم اغفر لي, Allah says, قَدْ فَعَلْتُ, I have done that. When you say, Allah forgive me, Allah says, I have done that. I have forgiven you. And when you say, اللهم ارحمني, Allah says, فَعَلْتُ, I have done that. Allah have mercy on me, I have done that. And when you say, اللهم ارزقني, oh Allah provide me, Allah says, قَدْ فَعَلْتُ, I have done that. Meaning I've made the decision to provide you. Yes, I will provide you. I will give you. So, what do we learn from this? So, the Bedouin man, he counted these 7 on his fingers, and then he went away happily. So, what are these 7 azkar? Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahumma ghfirli, Allahumma arhamni, Allahumma arzuqni. Whenever you need anything, anything, even if you need a phone cover, literally, because even that can become difficult. Anything you need replaced, we keep turning to our family members and husbands and fathers and we keep annoying them. And at the same time, we feel guilty. They're so busy. They don't have time. How can they help us? They can barely do their own things. How can they help me? Before turning to them, ask Allah. Ask Allah. He is Dhul Quwwa. He is the possessor of power. What is Quwwa? Quwwa is such a characteristic with which the doer, he can do whatever he wills without any weakness. So it's the opposite of it's weakness. It's the opposite of weakness. Meaning he does not have any darf. He does not have any weakness. He's Dhul Quwwa. He's the possessor of Quwwa. Meaning ultimate power is with who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And notice how this is mentioned right after Razzaq. Because many times people have something they want to give you, but they don't have the power to give you. They're weak because somebody is going to object. Somebody is going to fine them. Somebody is going to be unhappy. They have the means, but they don't have the power. They don't have the ability. They don't have that freedom. Allah is Al-Razzaq Dhul Quwwa, and He is Al-Mateen. Al-Mateen. This is further emphasizing Dhul Quwwa. And Al-Mateen Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu described as Shadeed, meaning firm and severe and strong. Meaning he's firm in his izzah, in his honor, in his might. Firm in all of his attributes. Because Alladhi la yamut, the one who will not die. The one who is above any weakness. So he is Al-Mateen. Next is Isbatu Sam'i wal Basari lillahi subhanahu. Isbat. Affirming, affirmation of. As-Sam'i. What is As-Sam'i? Hearing. Wal-Basar and the seeing. Lillahi for Allah subhanahu. Glory be to Him. Meaning, what's the evidence, what's the proof that Allah hears and He sees? Because we learned earlier that there are some people who do ta'til. And what is ta'til? To abandon the attribute. They say that, okay, He is As-Sami' but bila Sam'. He is Al-Basir but bila Basar. He doesn't see, He doesn't hear. Because if you say that He hears and sees, then you are describing Him. You're doing takyif. And you are doing tamseel. You are resembling Him to the creation. But how is it that we believe that Allah is As-Sami' and Basir? He has Sam' and Basar? Without ta'til, without takyif, without tamseel. And without tahrif. Because those who did ta'til, they also did tahrif. Because they didn't want to believe that Allah, He speaks. So they altered the words of the Quran. They changed them. They did tahrif also. So what belief is of al-firqatun najiyya, those who are saved from these base and cheap ways, that they believe in Allah as Allah has described Himself. Allah describes Himself. وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى, and His statement, exalted He is, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. This ayah itself explains. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like Him. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. And He hears and He sees. Which means that He hears like no other. And He sees like no other. So when you believe that Allah has the attribute of samar and basar, then it doesn't mean that you're describing him. You're just describing him with the description that he has given. Right? And it doesn't mean that you are likening him to his creation. You're resembling him with his creation. Because laysa kamithlihi shay', there is nothing like him. So these are Allah's names that show his attributes. As-Samir, Al-Basir. وَقَوْلِهِ and his statement, إِنَّ اللَّهَ indeed Allah, ni'immah, how excellent, how good, يَعِظُكُمْ بِهِ is that which he advises you with, that which he instructs you with. Meaning, what a good, what an excellent instruction Allah is giving you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ indeed Allah, كَانَ he is ever, سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا, hearing and seeing. Notice, كَانَ. What does كَانَ show? كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. Always. He always was, is, and will be. Meaning he always possessed these attributes, he possesses them now, and he will forever possess these attributes. Samir, Basir. He hears and he sees. Now, Samr, hearing, when we speak of Samr with respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what does it mean that he hears? What does it mean? That he hears whatever that can be heard, meaning any sound. Any sound. Now some sounds we can hear, because our ears are such that can perceive those sounds. And there are other sounds in which we cannot hear. Do they exist? Yes. Right? Now, we have limited ability. Why? Because we are limited. We are human beings. We are the creation. If we can hear one thing, we cannot hear another. If we are in one room and we're hearing the conversation of two people, we cannot hear the conversation that's taking place in another place. If we're standing in a kitchen, right under the exhaust fan, with that noise, what happens? Every other sound is drowned. We can't hear it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-samir, which means that he perceives every sound. He hears every sound. And this is further divided in three categories. The fact that he hears, idraku sawt. So first of all, that he hears every sound, meaning there is no sound except that he hears it. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا. Allah heard the statement of the woman who was arguing with you about her husband. Aisha radhiallahu anha, what did she say? I was there, I didn't hear. Allah above the seven heavens on his arsh, he heard her. So, idraku sawt, meaning he hears every sound. Secondly, this means he hears, meaning he also assists and helps. Like Musa alayhi salam and Harun alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, innani ma'akuma asma'u wa ara. I'm with you, I hear you and I see you. I hear you and I see you. Meaning I hear every sound of yours and every sound that is said to you. So I am watching you, I am protecting you, I am helping you. You understand? Because why is it that we watch out for sounds? Like for example, a baby is sleeping. Why is it that our ears are there constantly? Why? So that we can help. Right? Thirdly, it also gives meaning of wa'id, meaning his threat. He threatens. You know, like children are talking and you say, I heard you. I heard you. I know what you've said. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he has heard or he hears, then this is a warning also. First of all, it means that there is nothing beyond him, meaning every sound he hears. Secondly, that he will help you if you're deserving of his help. And thirdly, it's a warning also. How? Like in the Quran we learn, أَمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّا لَا نَسْمَعُ سِرَّهُمْ وَنَجْوَاهُمْ. Do they think that we don't hear their sir and their najwa? What goes on in their hearts secretly and what they converse privately? We hear everything. We hear what they say. So it's a threat. So when we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-samir, Allah hears, we believe that he perceives every sound, we believe that he hears us, he will help us, and because he hears, he will hold us accountable. And also remember that samr also means that he responds. He is Mujib. He responds. He answers the prayers, the calls, the requests of his servants, because he is As-Samir. And Basir, what does that mean? That he sees. What does he see? Everything. Even though it may be hidden, he sees. And which means he has complete knowledge. Nothing is hidden from him, meaning he sees everything and he knows everything. Why is it that we don't know about many things? Because we don't see them. Right? We don't see the problem. We don't see the error. But Allah sees it, even though it is hidden. He knows about it. The next is Isbatul Mashi'ati wal Iradati lillahi subhanahu. Isbat, the affirmation of Al Mashi'ah. What is Mashi'ah? Intention to execute. Wal Irada. Irada is will. Lillahi subhanahu. For Allah. Meaning, Allah the Exalted, He has a will. He wills. He intends. He intends to execute. First of all, he wants to do something. He wants. Which means that there are certain things that he wants. Then he does it. He executes his will. And what he wills always happens. Meaning if he intends to do something, then there is no stopping. Allahumma la mani'a lima a'tayta wa la mu'tiya lima mana'ta. So when he wants to do something, he does it. And what he wills always happen. Okay? You see, we as people, do we have certain intentions and do we also will? Yes. But what happens to that? Sometimes it's executed and sometimes it is not. Like for example, in the morning you intend. At night you intend that you will fast the next day. You want to. Want. That want is there. But what happens at suhoor time? You say, I change my mind. I'm too tired. Tomorrow, inshallah. You changed. Why? Because you're weak. You're weak. So it caused, that weakness caused a failure to your plans. Right? Also what happens? We make the intention. We want to keep a fast the next day. We set the alarm, but we don't hear it, and we don't wake up. And we wake up at Fajr. It's too late. We weren't able to execute our will. We want to say something. It's ready in our head. But what happens when we see the person? Forget. Everything gone. We want to write something. It's literally, you know, we can see the words. It's literally at the tip of our pen, but what happens as we're writing? We forget. We will, we have a want, but we're not capable of executing everything. Correct? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is above any weakness of forgetfulness or of being overcome. In the Quran, so many times we learn, وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. You cannot at all cause failure to Allah. What does it mean? That when Allah intends to do something, He will execute it. And also remember that His will, sometimes He intends to do something and other times He intends that something should not happen. That is also within His control. وَقَوْلِهِ and His statement, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. This is from where? Surah Al-Kahf, the story of the two gardens, right? Where one person who was showing off to his friend about his garden, what happened? Allah destroyed it, right? So his companion, he said, why didn't you do this? That when you entered your garden, you said, Masha Allah, whatever Allah willed. Whatever Allah willed. Meaning if this garden is good and it is beautiful, this is because Allah wanted it to be like that. Allah allowed it to be like that. La quwwata illa billah. There is no power except with Allah. All power is with Him. What does it mean? That He executes His will. Next ayah, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ If Allah wanted, مَا قُتَتَلَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ The people after them would not have fought. Who is this talking about? The followers of the prophets. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ After the clear proofs came to them. وَلَكِنْ اِخْتَلَفُوا But they differed. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَفَرَ So with this difference, some believed and others disbelieved. So that ummah that was one became divided. And with this division, what happened? Animosity. And out of that animosity, fights, killing. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ And if Allah wanted, مَا قُتَتَلُوا They would not have killed each other. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَفْعَلُ مَا يُرِيدُ But Allah does whatever He intends. Now there's a couple things over here. First of all, at the beginning, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا قُتَتَلَ If Allah wanted, they would not have fought. Which means that, Allah let them fight. If He wanted, He could have prevented them. But He did not want, so He did not prevent. Which means that He let them fight. So if they fought, that was with Allah's permission. You understand? Now there's two things we see here. That one thing that happens, it's good. It happens by Allah's will, His permission. And the other thing is that which is evil. And that also happens with Allah's will. Because He allowed it. He willed it. He let it happen. Even though it's evil, He let it happen. Remember that when it comes to what Allah commands, what He legislates, remember that that is something that He likes. And secondly, that which Allah allows, that which Allah lets happen. Meaning He does not stop it. He lets it happen. So for example, people fighting each other, killing each other. This is something that Allah does not necessarily like. So there are two matters. One, which He commands, which He orders, which He legislates. Ash-shari. That which is ash-shari, that which is from the sharia, part of the sharia. That is something that Allah likes. So for example, if Allah commanded us to pray. You understand? He commanded us to pray. He commanded that the man, his share of inheritance should be twice as that of the woman. لِلذَّكَرِ حَظُّ الْأُنْسَيَيْنِ Okay? That is something that Allah likes. And remember that there is a wisdom behind that. The second is kauni affairs. They are sometimes good and they are sometimes bad. But remember that it's not necessary that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes them. That He wants to hurt His servant. Like for example, death. Death. Is it certain for every human being? Yes. It's certain. Now, every person will eventually die. The righteous also. And the wicked also. The prophets, did they die? Yes. Did Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam suffer from death? Yes. Allah wanted that a servant should die at a specific time. But remember, He wanted that the servant should die at that time. But it doesn't mean that He loves the pain for the servant. You understand? It doesn't mean that He likes that His servant should suffer. And this is a very important point to understand. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ So much evil is happening in the world. No? And this is what people question about all the time. If there is God, why is He allowing this? How come He's letting all of this happen? Why did so-and-so die? Why do we die? If Allah wants, He can stop all of this from happening. He can. It's within His power. But He lets it happen. Why? Because there's a reason behind that. There's a reason behind that. And what is the reason? There's different reasons. There's a different hikmah. So over here, وَلَكِنْ اِخْتَلَفُوا فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَفَرَ From this, what happened? Those who truly believed, their iman was exposed. And those who didn't, those who did kufr, their kufr was exposed. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلُوا But remember again, Allah still has the will and the power and the ability to stop them. Don't think that Allah does not care. He's not ghafil. He's fully aware. And He's watching, he's listening to everyone, how each person is behaving, how each person is acting in each situation, and he will hold people accountable. ولكن الله يفعل ما يريد. Allah does whatever he intends. So, what do we learn from this? That legal commandments, they're also his will, and what happens in the universe, that is also his will. Whatever he wants, he allows it, he lets it happen. Whatever he does not want, he prevents it, he does not let it happen. And he does not need your permission or approval for that. So whether it's a shar'i matter or a kauni matter, does Allah need our permission? Does he need our approval? No. Why? Because he is God. He is the master. And who are we? Slaves and servants. He is above and beyond us. So you understand? The fact that he can do anything that he wants, he can. If he wants, he can throw the entire creation in hellfire. If he wants, he can do it. Nobody can question him. لا يسأل عما يفعل. He's not questioned about what he does. وهم يسألون. But they will be questioned. So what we should be concerned about is not why Allah is letting this happen. What should we be concerned about? What am I doing? Why did Allah give this command? Why do I have to do this? Don't worry about it. There's good. There's good behind it. What should you be concerned about? What should we be concerned about? What do I have to do? What is it that Allah has legislated? وَقَوْلِهِ and his statement, أُحِلَّتْ لَكُمْ بَهِيمَةُ الْأَنْعَامِ. Permissible for you are the animals of livestock. إِلَّا مَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ. Except that which has been already recited on you, meaning that which you are already told from before that it is not permissible. غَيْرَ مُحِلِّ الصَّيْدِ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمْ. Don't make the sayd, the hunt, lawful, meaning don't hunt while you are in the state of ihram. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ مَا يُرِيدُ. Indeed, Allah commands whatever He wants. Meaning, He can make whatever halal and He can make whatever He wants halal. He doesn't need your approval. He doesn't need your permission. وَقَوْلِهِ and His statement, فَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ. Whoever Allah intends to guide. Notice, yurid. He intends to guide. يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. He opens up his chest to Islam. When Allah intends to guide somebody, then what happens? That person, his chest is opened up to Islam. Opened up to Islam, meaning Allah gives him the ability to find the truth, to appreciate the truth, to willingly accept the truth. This is his rizq, right? Allah gives that person the special rizq. So deen becomes easy, acceptable to that individual. Learning is facilitated. Opportunities are provided. فَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ. And whoever he intends, أَنْ يُضِلَّهُ, that he should lead him astray. He should let him go astray. يَجْعَلْ صَدْرَهُ ضَيِّقًا. He makes his chest tight. حَرَجًا. Narrow. Constricted. كَأَنَّمَا يَصَّعَدُ فِي السَّمَاءِ. As if he is struggling to go up in the sky. Meaning he is out of breath. He's so uncomfortable. He just wants to get out. This is how much he detests Islam. He avoids it. He keeps away from the Quran. He keeps away from the gatherings of knowledge because he feels suffocated. So, what do we learn from this ayah? That Allah has so much power to execute His will that guidance and misguidance are also in His hands. Whoever Allah wills to guide, He guides him. And whoever Allah decides that this person should not be guided, then that person cannot ever find guidance. Everything that happens, happens with whose will? Allah's will. Whose permission? His permission. Does he need our approval? No. Do we need his approval? Of course. Because we cannot even eat something or digest something without his will, his permission. He is the Khaliq and we are the مخلوق. He is the Malik and we are the Mamluk. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.